Hello everybody, welcome back to my channel where skincare is all about progression over perfection. Be spitty then for no reason, because perfection doesn't exist. First of all, I'm using like a noise cancelling setting on my headphone because there is a full-on construction thing happening outside. It actually looks pretty interesting, but they're drilling, they're banging, so if the audio sounds a little bit weird, it's because of that, but hopefully it sounds okay. I had like a blank space in my calendar today as to what to film, so I just kind of want to be petty for a little bit. I want to do my morning routine, morning skincare routine, and just complain about a few things that brands do that annoy me. I also asked you guys over on Instagram about things that brands do that annoy you, so we'll go through them as well. So yeah, no hate to any brand. This is just for fun. I know I'm being pedantic, I'm being petty, but you know, things are allowed to annoy us, right? Okay, so let's get into my morning routine. I've really started to enjoy wearing color contacts again, like I'm 25 again, and I discovered this brand called Moody Lenses. This isn't sponsored. They have gifted me some stuff, but I've also spent a lot of money on their website. The ones I've got in now, I'll show you. They're very subtle. Rosette Nebula. These ones are a daily disposable, but I got like yearly, monthly, all that kind of stuff. They do so many. I mean, look at that. I don't know if you can see them, but they're like a rose, and they've also got like a gold glitter going throughout them. I'll put a picture from their website because it looks a lot better. But what I love about this brand, and I mean, I love this brand. This is a mix of stuff I've bought myself and stuff they've gifted me. These are also ones I wear whenever I go like to events or anything. They're like pink with like a purple ring around them, but it all sounds kind of like, oh my God, that's really colorful. But what I love about them is they do like greens, pinks, purples, blues, even gold, like glittery flecks throughout the lenses, but it doesn't look out of this world like zany. It looks very natural, and I know it sounds really stupid, but I never feel like I'm wearing like theatrical colored contacts. I feel like I'm wearing really nice, natural, there's like a glint to my eye kind of thing, and they're so comfortable. I've worn colored contacts before that were like hard, they almost hurt, but these feel like my normal prescription contacts, and they come with all the stuff you need, like a little kit to help get them in your eye, obviously to clean them properly. Get free contact lens cases as well, like when you buy a certain amount. And I bought this like little mirror thing. I don't know why. I thought it was cute. What I love is whenever you order from them, they come with like a whole thing about how to apply them, how to be hygienic and how to be careful with them. Because after all, we are putting stuff on our eye. But I don't know. I just kind of like them. I like having like a little something extra, you know. I don't wear makeup, so it's nice to be like, oh, sunk in my eye. Also, I've just trimmed my beard, so there might be little hairs everywhere. But the first thing I do, usually if I've not been sweaty during the night, if it's not hot, if I've not been sweating, if I've not used any really thick, heavy overnight creams or emollients or occlusives, even anything like that, then I will just go over my face with my micellar water. This is the Bioderma pink flavor. I don't know its actual name. This is one of the only micellar waters I can leave on without my skin feeling irritated and itchy. I bought this because Lab Muffin, Michelle from Lab Muffin, recommended it. Well, not to me personally, but through one of her videos. And her recommendations yet to fail me. So yeah, I just do a once over this. I'll also do this in the evening if I've not been like wearing sunscreen, if I've stayed inside and the UV index is like 3 and below, then I just won't bother with like washing my face. And it really has helped my rosacea, along with a few other bits I'm going to show you today. Okay, so the first thing brands do that really, really bother me, and this is going to be from a consumer perspective and an influencer perspective. I hate when brands pretend their packaging is recyclable by emptying it, then putting a flower in it and pretending their packaging is a vase. I told you it was gonna be petty, I told you. But there are so many brands that do this thing, it's like how to upcycle our packaging. And it's always, always a vase, or put your cotton buds in one of these, or your pads in one of these, or put, you know, use it as storage. But what? I feel stupid. I feel stupid even making this video. Why this annoys me is because a few reasons. One, I just want to recycle it. I don't want all this shit laying around the house. If your packaging is recyclable, I'm just going to recycle it. I don't want to upcycle it. I just want it to be recyclable, because then what's going to happen? I'm going to have a room full of skincare vases and storage made of other things. Not so much when it's like, I think like Glow Recipe did it. They did it in their BHA watermelon bottle, and it actually looks so nice because their packaging is glass. And it's all like this, right? But another brand did it who just had like a plastic, like a normal plastic container. And I was like, and they were like, you know, our products may not be recyclable, but you can upcycle it and make it into a vase. No, I don't want that kind of shit lying around the house. You know, I don't have kids. And one of those reasons is because I don't want them bringing stuff back from school that they made in school that I then have to put on the fridge and have lying around the house. I don't want to be doing that myself as an adult, just leaving DIY shit all over the house. It's so petty. But whenever I see a brand being like, you know, like Eco Week or Eco Month, and it's like upcycle by using our packaging as storage, I'm not going to do that. Who's going to do that? Who has bottles just lying around as storage? No. And also, you can't keep much in them. It's not good storage. You can turn anything into storage if you want to. You know what I mean? Next, I'm going to rehydrate with the Undefined R&R Mineral Mist. This has magnesium, sea kelp, and niacinamide. And what I find this does, especially as the weather's getting warmer here, meaning it's hotter and humid, it really helps control my sebum, my excessive oils, especially my T-zone. But we have aloe leaf juice in here as well, so it's nice and moisturizing. We have kakadu plum, so a little bit of antioxidant in here. It's just so nice and refreshing. So I spray that over and then quickly apply my serum. I'm going to be using the Ample End Ceramide Ample. This is a product that's been reintroduced in my routine from Olive Young, if you watched Wednesday's video. You know I used to use this all the time. It's just a very ceramide enriched serum that I forgot about and Olive Young reintroduced me to. Right, the next one, which a lot of you actually agreed with me on, is brands posting memes. And you know, it makes sense sometimes if it's like the brand's thing, if we know it's like a, you know, like millennial, like Gen Z kind of like led brand. Oh, sorry. Yeah. Ceramides just to help strengthen my skin barrier. And that's something else that's been really helping with my rosacea. I think what the most annoying thing is that every single brand does it. So after the Met Gala, we had every single brand like showing a picture of a celebrity with their assistants around them. And the celebrity would be like me and it'd be like SPF, vitamin C, niacinamide. And it's like, and every brand was doing the same thing. It's almost cringy in the sense that it's kind of like your like fun auntie sending you memes. Like, oh, look at this meme I found on Facebook. It's like a minion meme. And you're like, that's not funny. But it's every single brand all the time. And whenever, like the Jubilee is going to happen here. Was it Jubilee? I don't care. Whatever's happening here in the UK, I just know every single UK brand is going to be posting Queen memes about skincare. And I just don't want it clogging my feed. And it's just cringy if it doesn't feel natural. It's like a load of people have gathered in a boardroom and be like, what can we do to stay young and fresh and kind of keep up with Gen Z? Let's post some memes. And it's just constant. It's constant. And it's just not funny. It's not funny. It's just cringe. I like brands just to talk about themselves and be a bit professional. I do like brands where they become a bit more personal and have a personality, because I think it's important to see brands as a person. You have to think, would I support this person? Would I hang out with this person? You know, but the constant kind of like posting of meme just to post out some content is kind of, it's just clogging up my timeline. And as I said, it's repetitive. Every single brand is doing it. It doesn't make a brand stand out as something unique because you post fun memes. Okay, here's one from an influencer perspective. And whilst I absolutely love this, I also hate it at the same time. So you know when brands on Instagram are like, or Twitter are like, tag your favorite creators, like a skincare brand will be like, tag your favorite creators. And I'll get tagged in them and I love it. And I'm always like, thank you so much. And some of the people I get tagged alongside, I'm like, oh my God, like you watch me and them? I'm like, you know. But what this is a tactic for brands to then harass influencers. And I know it sounds really awful, but what then happens is a brand contacts you and they're like, you've been chosen to receive some free PR. And it's like, I don't want that. They act like being chosen, but like, oh, you know, you've been waiting for this. We've chosen you. We've selected you. And it's like, I didn't ask you. Like, I don't want that. And it's kind of spammy now. And as grateful as I am for it, what it is them seeing who's popular or who gets tagged the most, who they think is worthy of their PR, when I don't think that's how it should work. Nowadays, I think it's important to consider, as you know, someone working for a brand, that subscriber count isn't everything. I'm on what, like 1.4 million, but I could be getting the same amount of views as someone on 600,000. The subscriber count isn't the be all and end all of how popular you are or how well your content does or how engaged your audience is, more importantly. And what these kind of like tag your favorite creators things do is they just get the people who are tagged the most and then send them PR, hoping that their products will get seen the most. When I'm someone, like not being like I'm someone, but I get sent loads of PR, their PR isn't, you know, it's not a guarantee. Where I feel like a good tactic nowadays is to try and build a relationship with an influencer rather than just shipping them out some product and hoping they talk about it. Because there are brands that I've not even paid attention to. Then their PR or CEO or creators have got in touch with me. We've had dialogue and they told me about their process and their products. And I got to try them for a couple of months. And then it really draws me in. And I think whatever creator you are, whatever size, we are all like that. Do you know what I mean? I think there's this idea that people who are like 10K will just take anything, talk about anything. But I don't think that's the case. And I think that's a very old fashioned way for PR people to be looking at influencers. I did work in that kind of sector for about 2-3 years. So I kind of know the little tactics and what people do, but I just feel like asking people for names and then shipping them out some PR hoping they'll talk about it is not the way to do it. It also becomes very spammy for us influencers, with just an inbox of brands. I have an email for a reason as well. That's another thing. I have an email. I don't answer my emails. My manager does. Okay, that all sounds very ungrateful, but it's more like, it's just annoying. Here's one that so many of you agreed with as well. When brands call you babe, hun, dear friend, like all that kind of stuff, it's not relatable. It doesn't make me like you, as you agree with as well. It's annoying. It comes across as unprofessional. Like there's relatability. Like hun would really suit some brands. Babe would suit some brands, but not every single brand. I got an email from a brand who I won't mention, but they are a higher end, expensive, bougie brand, all about science, all that kind of stuff. And they sent me an email saying, hi, babe. I was like, no. Like, you don't, let's be professional for a bit. And then when we're friendly, you can call me whatever you want. But what I got from a lot of you guys is that even in like newsletters, over Twitter, Instagram, when a brand is calling you babe, hun, whatever, you do not appreciate it. You want a level of professionalism, especially when you're complaining about something, you're asking about an order, you're asking, you know, customer service. You don't want to be called babe or hun. I started kind of like ironically saying hun and kind of stuck. And me and my brothers kind of take the piss out of brands saying babe and hun all the time, because and that's what we'll call other people. And as I mentioned, I love brands being relatable, but there's a difference between being like, hey, like how can we help, and being like, hi babe, what can we do for you, hun? Do you mean it feels very, very too relaxed, right? Okay, next up, I'm gonna go in with my moisturizer. This is the Aestura Atto Barrier Hydro Soothing Cream. Again, this is a barrier repair moisturizer that's watery. It's not thick, it's not creamy, it's not suffocating, which is perfect for the morning. That adds a layer of hydration while soothing and repairing the skin as well. There are just little hairs everywhere. I should have trimmed after. Here's another thing I get annoyed with. So I have a twin brother, as we know, who's also an influencer, is a makeup artist on here. I hate it when brands confuse us. Not because I'm a twin and I'm like, don't you know who I am? But because it shows a lack of proper research when sending an influencer PR, reaching out to an influencer. It shows that all you've done is taken that person at literal face value and decided to get in touch. These are the kind of people that are like, hey, Robert, we love your videos about skincare. It's like, no, you don't, because you know the skincare twin is called James and you don't love the videos because you'll be watching them all the time and you would know that. Do you know what I mean? All they've done is seen a name, seen that he looks like me, thinks that we're the same person. Lack of research. So yeah, that's one thing that really bothers me that I know no one can relate to. But also, I guess in the same thing, it's like when brands reach out and they're like, hey, we love your videos. We think you'd be great for our brand. And then it's a wallet. I'm like, what makes you think? I feel like every influencer get those ones. Or when brands are like, we love what you do, we love what you talk about, and they're like, we are a clean beauty brand. It's like, well, you obviously don't, because you know I hate that term. You know I never advertise that. But anyway, let's get into what you guys really, really hate. So I'm going to keep names off just in case for privacy reasons. So this person says, tired of seeing terrible quality TikToks as the sole advertising. Give me a beautiful campaign. Do you want? I completely agree. I think social media like TikTok and Instagram is a great way to advertise your product through influencers. But I don't want to see, I'm from a fashion and photography background and I love those campaigns. I'm not saying I want to see everything highly edited, hundreds of thousands spent on a campaign, but I do want to see, I like seeing art. I love knowing what the product's about. I like seeing beauty shots of the product, not really the models, but you know, and I feel like you can take real skin and equality and inclusion with the high-end kind of beauty and merge those two together. I've not seen anyone do that. And I think there's no reason why that shouldn't be done. When it comes to like TikTok campaigns and lower quality, I love seeing what other influencers and everyday consumers say about a product, but I don't want that to be the main advert. I agree with you on that one. I agree with you. When a brand only responds to you if you call them out on social media, they ignore DMs. Yes. And I would be lying if I didn't say that I didn't use my verified tick on all platforms, especially Twitter, to get immediate customer service. Because this is the thing, is there's some terrible, terrible customer service. And as someone who's worked in retail over the phones, you know, on help desks, all that kind of stuff, I really value good customer service. And I think it should be given wherever you work. So if it takes someone to publicly call you out after 9 months, right, I've got a story for you. I ordered a mirror mid last year. It took 4 months before I even heard from them. And I was like, you know what, actually, I kind of don't want this mirror anymore. Can I just get my money back? And they're like, oh, we'll send it to you next week. And I was like, okay, great. Next week came, they didn't send it. I messaged them, we'll send it to you on this date. That date came, I didn't get it. So 7 months later, I was like, I just want my refund, give me my money back. So they were like, fine, we'll sort that out, no worries. Me being me, I didn't check for the refund. I get an email saying that they're going to deliver the mirror to me next week. And I was like, no, I really just want my refund. They ignored me. They ignored me for 3 weeks until I called them out on social media and I got an instant refund. I hate it when brands do that. Just be good. Just have good customer service. I agree. Hello Fresh. Okay. Okay, I'm going to put this with a brand launches a new product and they and every influencer advertises it at the same time. One thing I hate that brands do is launch a new product and then get every single influencer within that genre to post a sponsored post at the same time. That's me watching, for example, Hello Fresh. It kind of becomes spam now because everyone is doing it. And they could at least let you stack those discount codes if we're going to have to see their advert all the time. They can, like, you know, pay us maybe if I have to sit through it now. I do like Hello Fresh, though. They were good. But when a brand launches new products and every single influencer you watch is advertising it, it's overbearing. And I honestly don't think it's the best selling technique. I think, you know, do a core amount of people when it's new, but then kind of spread it out or let people talk about it before it's released. Because a lot of brands get us influencers to try their products before, months and months before the release. So it'll be good to be like, this is coming up, or, you know, it's been out for a couple months now. This is what, you know, I've got hair there. Everyone's saying about this, what consumers think about it. It just becomes overbearing. And I think it's a lazy selling technique. What do you think? I think it's a bit too much. Huge launch parties full of celebs. How is that going to provide decent reviews? It's just pics of flower walls. Yeah. I agree. And this is why, Percy, I don't understand events. I was saying that I went to a Glow Recipe event recently, which was great. And that didn't, like, usually when you go to an event, people are like, oh, can you post some pictures, or you're under a contract to do so. I wasn't. I doubt anyone there was under that kind of contract. These are all people who have worked with Glow Recipe before. It felt like more of a thank you for the influencers kind of thing. And people did just post, you know, shots of what was going on. But I understand, it's like, I don't understand brand trips, launch parties. I don't get what benefit that has for the brand, because I don't think influencers then go away thinking, you know what, that was a great launch party, or celebrities go away thinking that was a great launch party. I'm so interested in this brand now. Like, I really don't. I don't. It's just an excuse to be seen somewhere and have pictures or meet up with their friends, which is all good. It's all fine. You know, it's just part of being an influencer. But I don't think consumers are looking at being like, oh, wow. All these celebrities are at the launch for this product. I wonder what that product is. I don't think people are like that anymore. I don't think people care that much anymore. So I'm going to do my sunscreen. This is the one that's a serum by Hello Sunday, SPF 45. I do have a sponsored post coming up with these guys, but this has been my one of my go-to sunscreens for about 2 years now. You'll see how, sorry, I'm just trying to get, I'm coming to the end of this bottle, so I'm like digging in the bottom. You'll see how, like, it's like a Korean sunscreen. It's available in Boots and online, selected Boots and online. Okay, I wasn't going to mention the exact brands, but I agree with this one. Charlotte Tilbury, Hello Darling. And so many people said this. The thing is, and I don't know if this is just me being me, but I don't like seeing brand founders in their own advertising campaign. But I also think there's a lot of bad connotations linked with the bouginess and the oh, darling, darling. It's very old school fashion industry. It's very kind of like, you know, double kiss on the cheek. And not a lot of people can relate to that kind of life. And it's just a bit grating, isn't it? It's a bit much. Like, I also don't like being called darling. Like, please don't call me darling. I'm an adult. I don't want someone call me darling unless they're my good friend. Unless they're my friend Laura. She can call me darling. But other than that, I'm just like, I don't want you calling me that. Like, I don't know you. We're not all your darlings. It also, for me, that kind of thing puts them kind of like in this superiority kind of complex kind of thing. We're like, oh, darling, like, oh, you're below. It feels very kind of like below me kind of thing. I don't know if I'm overthinking that, but it does make me cringe a fair bit. Any brand with a mineral sunscreen advertising on dark skin. Yes, this is by Glow Skin Guy, who's an amazing content creator as well. I'll link down below. What also, and I think he actually had this issue, is when a brand advertises a mineral sun, this is why I hate this whole chemical sunscreens are bad for the environment, they're bad for your skin. They're not. Stop pushing mineral sunscreens as the superior sunscreen, because not everyone can use them. Not everyone has to use them. They're not the better alternative. They're not the worst alternative, but they're not the better of the two. And I think it was Glow Skin Guy who, please do correct me if I'm wrong, but who actually tried a sunscreen and he was like, I'm using the right amount. There's a white cast, and the brand messaged him and told him he was using it wrong, because they were sure that this product wouldn't give a white cast on black skin when it did. Like, how else are you meant to use sunscreen if you use the correct amount? Like, and also Alicia, who's another amazing content creator and esthetician, says the way they rarely test their mineral SPF on people of color before making wild claims. Yes, this whole it's invisible, it's naked on the skin. This is the same with tinted sunscreens for me, because a lot of brands presume just because they got a tint in their sunscreen, the white cast isn't going to show up. It's still a tint. It's still a color that isn't darker skin. You know what I mean? Like, even I struggle when I'm a very pale tan, and sometimes I'll get a tinted sunscreen and it's like, why am I orange? Why am I orange now? So I'm going to finish off with the e.l.f. Hydrating Core Lip Shine. It's just a lip balm. I kind of like this. It's quite nice. It's got a little tint to it. It tastes a little bit like American grape. I really like it. And then I'm done. I'm done for the day. I'm actually just staying in today, so I'm a little bit like shinier than usual. I probably wouldn't have moisturized if I was going out. I would have just used the sunscreen. But yeah, staying in today, so my skin is well cared for. Let me know what you think about these things. I don't know if I'm just being petty or if this is something that, you know, winds everyone up. I feel like it's so hard nowadays to be a brand and tick all the boxes, and that's certainly not what I expect from brands. I really just think it's about brands being themselves, but also thinking about who they're her audience actually are. And just because they're younger, they don't have to call everyone hun, for example, or post memes. But yes, let me know what you think in the comments down below. You can watch my When Beauty Turns Ugly series here, and some general light entertainment here, and I'll see you over there.